Welcome to this SnapGene tutorial on restriction enzyme cloning. In this video, we will describe what restriction enzymes are and what makes them useful cloning tools. We will also discuss some of their limitations when used in cloning. Restriction enzymes were identified in bacteria in the 1970s. There is a microscopic war continually going on that most humans are unaware of. This is the battle for life between bacteriophage and bacteria. Bacteriophage are small viruses that infect bacteria. As you can see here, after injecting its DNA into the host bacterium, the bacteriophage takes control of the host cell's replication machinery. This could be devastating for the bacteria. However, bacteria have evolved mechanisms to protect themselves. One of these mechanisms is the restriction and modification system. There are two important parts to the restriction and modification system. The first is the restriction enzyme. In order to defend themselves from the bacteriophage, bacteria have evolved sequence-specific DNA endonucleases. As you can see in this diagram, the restriction enzyme cuts the bacteriophage DNA into small fragments, preventing the bacteriophage from replicating. Left on its own, the bacterial restriction enzyme would be just as happy to cleave its own DNA. Thus, by luck or selection, bacteria have systems to protect their genome. Relevant to restriction and modification are the methylases that add methyl groups to the bacterial chromosome as it replicates. These methyl groups provide a number of functions. In this context, the presence of the methyl group prevents the restriction enzyme from destroying its own DNA. There are thousands of bacteria which contain restriction enzymes. Bacterial names are used to provide names to the restriction enzymes. The name of the enzyme comes from the genus and species designations of the bacteria and the strain indicator if there is one. In our first example, you can see how the genus, species, and strain initials from Escherichia coli RY13 create the ECOR designation. Restriction enzymes are then assigned a Roman numeral in the order they are found in a particular species. In this example, ECOR1 was identified first. ECOR-V, or ECOR5, was identified fifth. Restriction enzymes are categorized into four classes based on their structural complexity, recognition sequence, cleavage site position, and cofactor requirement. Type 2 enzymes are the most abundant and well-studied. There are over 4,000 known type 2 restriction enzymes, over 600 of which are commercially available. Type 2 restriction enzymes are the original workhorses of molecular biology. Since their original discovery, type 2 enzymes have been further subcategorized into smaller groups based on differences in their mechanisms of catalysis and/or the relative location of the cleavage site from the recognition site. Roughly 90% of all type 2 restriction enzymes are type 2P restriction enzymes. The P indicates that the recognition site is palindromic. Of these, a small number will tolerate up to 4 degenerate nucleotides in their recognition site. Restriction enzymes like HIN-F1 or DRA3 with a degenerate base or bases in their recognition site are generally not useful for cloning. Another subset of type 2 restriction enzymes is known as type 2S restriction enzymes. There are two important differences between type 2P and type 2S enzymes. First, type 2S do not have palindromic recognition sites. Second, the cleavage site is outside of the recognition site at a set distance. Type 2S enzymes have a special use in cloning that we will discuss in a separate video. The characteristics that make non-ambiguous type 2P restriction enzymes useful in cloning are that they have specific recognition sites, generally ranging from 4 to 8 bases in length. In addition, cleavage occurs at a specific location within the recognition site, resulting in predictable sequences at the point of DNA cleavage. In this example, you can see the type 2P restriction enzyme BAMH1 bound to a DNA helix. You are looking down the barrel of the helix, shown in light purple, with the enzyme represented by a ribbon diagram in blue and brown. Each monomer of the homodimer is seen as a mirror image of each other through the vertical axis of the structure. The protein-DNA interaction domains are shown, and each monomer cuts only one of the two sugar phosphate backbones. Cleavage by the dimer creates the double-stranded break. An easy but interesting fact to overlook is that the enzyme is binding DNA in its helical shape. The Watson-Crick hydrogen bonds are internal in the structure, but the nucleotides nonetheless expose distinct structures to the solvent/enzyme. The natural consequence of cleavage being achieved by a homodimer and the sequence specificity of cleavage is that the recognition sites of type 2 restriction enzymes, type 2P restriction enzymes, are palindromic. In the example with ECOR1, you can see that the top strand reads from 5' prime to 3', prime, G, A, T, T, C, with cleavage occurring between the G and the A. The exact same thing happens on the bottom strand when read from its 5' prime to 3' prime side. Cleavage by type 2P restriction enzymes always occurs between the 3' prime phosphate and the 5' prime hydroxyl of the sugar phosphate backbone. Cleavage is sequence specific. However, different enzymes cut at different locations within the recognition sequence, resulting in three different types of ends. In the top example, you can see the 5' prime protruding end generated by HindI-3 cleavage. HindI-3 will always cut at this recognition sequence and will always generate this overhang. In comparison, PST cuts farther along the 3' prime strand of its recognition sequence, creating a 3' prime protruding end after cleavage. A third example is when the enzyme cuts in the middle of the recognition sequence, creating a blunt end. Cloning with restriction enzymes is made possible by the enzyme DNA ligase. The role of DNA ligase in biology is the repair of gaps in DNA. In the lab, purified DNA ligase is used to covalently rejoin the ends of DNA together. To learn more about molecular cloning, visit snapgene.com.